Instructions. Take material from Orlando and connect it to any self-reflection on the new normal you might wish to address. Mix it, mash it, do what you will with it. Film in any way you want, anywhere you want. Consider our odd current circumstances in making your piece. Quarantine, isolation, global pandemic, social distancing, etc.
Virginia Woolf's Orlando, as adapted by Sarah Ruhl.
Orlando, a biography by Virginia Woolf.
The Orlando Project, a response to Orlando and the COVID-19 pandemic.
She flung herself upon the old oak tree. She took up her poem, sea-stained, blood-stained, travel-stained.
She had been working on it for close to 500 years now. She looked at the ring. She looked at the ink pot. Did she dare?
Hang it all, here goes. And she plunged her pen neck deep in ink. To her enormous surprise, she wrote. The words were a little long in coming, but come they did.
I will, Orlando thought. I will write a great poem about the oak tree.
Birds froze in midair and fell like stones to the ground. The present moment. No one need wonder that Orlando pressed her hand to her heart and turned pale. For what more terrifying revelation can there be than that it is the present moment? That we survive the shock at all is only possible because the past shelters us on one side and the future on the other. But we have no time now for such reflections. Orlando was terribly late.
So they would talk, and talk. How to cook an omelet, or to buy the best boots in London. Yes, yes. And when Orlando's feet were covered with spotted autumn leaves, Bonthrop, she would say. I'm off. And they talked 2 hours or more, perhaps about the sea or perhaps not about the sea. And really it would profit little to record what they said, for they knew each other so well that they could say anything, which is tantamount to saying nothing. Each visit began, continued, or concluded with a declaration of love. I love you. Thank you very much. But in between, there was much room for silence. I ate the biscuit. It's about all a fella can do nowadays.
The ship sank, and I was left, the only survivor on a raft, holding a biscuit. And then, I ate the biscuit. It's about all a fella can do nowadays.
Oh, hi. Didn't see you there. You just caught me in the middle of eating a biscuit. But really, cookies aside, there was obviously a lot of initial shock and disappointment. I talked very explicitly about how great 2020 was going to be because of all the things I was going to be able to do. And none of that is happening. Yeah, because what are you going to do? I was drawn to that line mostly because of the latter half, because he says, you know, what's a fella to do? You eat the biscuit, right? You take care of yourself as well as you can. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to go eat the rest of those cookies.
Thank you. time moves in such an interesting and, frankly, a little bit weird, peculiar way in Orlando, and time right now is moving in such a peculiar way during the current pandemic.
Who is there? Orlando took a silver candle in her hand and roamed once more through the halls, the galleries, the courts, the bedrooms. In this window seat, she had written her first verses. In that chapel, she would be buried. She, who believed in no immortality, could not help feeling that her soul would come and go forever. With the reds on the panels and the greens of the sofa, the house was no longer hers. It belonged to time now. I am growing up, she thought. I am losing some illusions, perhaps to acquire others. How strange it is. Nothing is any longer one thing. It was the present moment.
Hey there. Welcome back to my childhood bedroom. I am doing pretty well. What are we in? Week 2? Week 3? March 80th? No, it's April now. Yeah. The present moment that we survived the shock at all. It's only because we have the past and the future to shelter us. And when this was all kind of upheaved, I can't live in that future anymore, right? And so I'm forced, essentially, to live in the present. Every morning for the past several weeks, I get up, I meditate for 10 to 15 minutes. It's still snowing here. So be thankful that you don't have that.
And look, the lights in the houses. Hundreds of little rooms are lit, one precisely the same as the other. One can see everything in the little square-shaped boxes. There seems to be no privacy. None of those lingering shadows that there used to be. None of those women in aprons carrying wobbly lamps. At a touch, the whole room is bright. And the sky is bright all night long. The clock ticked louder and louder until there was a terrific explosion in Orlando's ear. Orlando leapt as if she had been violently struck on the head. 10 times she was struck. In fact, it was 10 o'clock in the morning. It was
the present moment. In all seriousness, this transition has been tough for a lot or majority of the people in a lot of different ways. And so when I was thinking of doing this passage where I saw it, and it was reminding me of Schertz talking about houses and how our outside landscape has rapidly evolved and transformed, but it made me think about also social media and the way that there is no privacy there, and there's hundreds of different pages and ways you can find someone and look at them and think that you like know their entire life without really meeting them. But then at the same time, in our present moment, we are staying sane, more or less, through social media and through our connections to others using technology.
I think I know the importance of nonverbal communication. And I know this because you taught me so.
They would speak of everything under
if
the
we
sun.
Do things well, they will last forever. Something before we go.
For instance, this man's beard. That woman's skin.
Well, the essential resists the telling, but the heart can't resist the love. And if it leaves, it's always nearby.
A rat that fed from my hand.
More than she was she, and I was I.
A face.
Where do we all go, my love? Where do we all go, my love? Where do we all go, my love? Where do we all go?
A feather.
Where do we all go, my love? Where do we all go, my love?
nothing was too small for such talk. Nothing was too great.
I am alone. He felt the need of something which he could attach his floating heart to. He wanted another landscape. The delights of love. Something hidden. In his mind, image followed image. He thought only of the pleasures of life, the green of the grass, the greeny, greeny, green of the grass. He wanted to match the shade of green. Greeny, greeny, green. Precisely. He felt the need of something which he could attach his floating heart to. Who is there?
Truth, truth, truth. The sun blazed, or there was darkness. Violence was all. Truth, truth, truth. Ah, romance, folly, poetry, youth. He walked up and down the ice. The sun was sinking rapidly. A howl of anguish against furious clouds. All was riot and confusion. Truth, truth, truth. As he spoke, tears ran down the sandy tracts of his cheeks. They reached the chapel. Light flew through the painted windows, and the words went dashing and circling like wild hawks among the towers. Faster and faster they circled, until they crashed and fell in a shower of fragments to the ground. It was harder to cry now. The present moment. Truth, truth, truth. And indeed, he looked as if he were burning with his own radiance, from a lamp lit within. What is your name, dear boy? You don't seem like yourself. You are many things to many people. You were filled with life, exquisitely. You were bursting with it. I hope that you will stay with me always. Truth, truth, truth. Life, life, life.
What is the most interesting and relevant connection you have made and continue to make between the current pandemic and Orlando, the play or the novel? For me, so much of Orlando deals with human connection and the various factors that affect such connections, and for many people, including myself, this pandemic has highlighted the importance of that human connection in a time where we have very little of it. And I find myself missing types of connection that I hadn't previously fully appreciated. Even something as simple as, like, having class in person. It's really taught me to be grateful for everything I experience, not just the overwhelmingly good aspects of my life, to be in the moment for everything, because it might vanish in the next.
I would like, Your Highness, at the present moment, to feel as though I am only one thing. She ran. A strange ecstasy came over her. I believe my ankle is broken, and yet I am content. I have found my mate. I am nature's bride. My hands shall wear no wedding ring. The roots shall twine about my fingers. I have sought happiness through many ages and not found it. Searched for fame and missed it. Love and not known it. I have known many men and many women, none have I understood. It is better that I lie in peace with the sky above me. I would very much like to be a poet, Your Highness.
No one need wonder that Orlando started, pressed her hand to her heart, and turned pale. For what more terrifying revelation can there be than that it is the present moment? That we survive the shock at all is only possible because the past shelters us on one side, and the future on another.
She wrote. The words were a little long in coming, but come they did. And the flowers bloomed and faded, and the sun rose and sank. And all the time she was writing, the world continued through wars and other calamities. She listened for the sounds of a carnival, for dice throwing and fortune telling, for shoving, tickling, pinching, pressing. No. Only the wind blew. There is a war on today. And so she wrote. And the flower bloomed and faded. And the sun rose and sank. Finally, Orlando dropped her pen and stretched her arms. Done, done, it's done! And the poem wanted to be read. Human beings had become necessary.
It was the present moment. But Orlando did not allow these sights to sink into her mind, even the fraction of an inch. Time has passed over me. Nothing could be seen whole or read from start to finish. What one saw beginning was never seen ended. Time has passed over me. I would like, Your Highness, at the present moment, to feel as though I am only one thing.
Nature. And letters. Nature and letters seem to have a natural antipathy. Bring them together, and they tear each other to pieces. The shade of green Orlando now saw spoilt his rhyme and split his meter. Nature. Nature has tricks of her own.
With Orlando, the play and the novel, and with the current pandemic and the climate that we're in right now, one of the lines particularly illuminates this, where human beings have become necessary. At the end, after they finish their oak tree, there's this desire to have it be read, to share it with other people in the world. And in our current pandemic, there's a desire just across the board to still be able to share creatively, to share just in general with other people.
The Archduchess sees Orlando and becomes instantly enamored and makes England essentially uninhabitable for him. So he flees to Constantinople. And I thought it was funny, just that image of the Archduchess, you know, waking up one day and realizing that their love is on the other side of the continent.
I was the one who had it all. I was the master of my fate. I never needed anybody in my life. I learned the truth too late. I'll never shake away the pain. I close my eyes, but he's still there. I let him steal into my melancholy heart. It's more than I can bear. Now I know he'll never leave me, even as he runs away. He will still torment me, call me, hurt me, move me, come what may. Waiting in my lonely duchy, wasting by an open door, I fool myself he'll walk right in and be with me forevermore.
The world was going on as usual. All the time she was writing, the world had continued. And if I were dead? It would be just the same.
No boy had ever had a mouth like that. No boy had those breasts. No boy had eyes which looked as if they had been fished from the bottom of the sea. His form combined in one, the strength of a man and a woman's grace. He, for there could be no doubt of his sex. This week I've been thinking a lot about the ways that my experience in quarantine have been affecting my perception of my gender, since I don't have to perform it for the world anymore. I'm not going out every day and fighting to be properly gendered with he pronouns, or they as well. Pronouns have meant so much to me throughout my life. The pronouns I have used have changed so many times. And all throughout it, I've realized that while the way I want the world to refer to me has changed, my solidness in who I am has stayed the same. So thinking about this clip, this idea that there's no doubt in my sex, even if it's something complicated, even if my sex isn't binary, that doesn't mean that there has to be doubt about what it is. And in this quarantine, I've gotten to explore it in all of its beauty and all of its glory and all of the bits of it that I originally shied away from because they would get me misgendered or because I was working so hard to be perceived as male since I knew I wasn't female. And now I've found this complicated mess of gender that I get to embody, and not having to put on gender for the rest of the world, getting to reevaluate my personal transformations because of the isolation that quarantine has brought has been one of the unique pleasures of it.
Hi, my name is Whitney Barrett. I am a cinema and media studies and a theater arts major and an English minor. I'm from just outside of Dallas, Texas, and I was going to be playing the role of Sasha, one of the chorus and the sea captain.
My name is Adam Ritter, and I was to play, among various ensemble characters, the Archduchess Harriet Griselda of Finster Airhorn Scandot Boom in the Romanian territory, as well as Shelmerdine Bonthrop Marmaduke, Esquire.
Hello, my name is Tias. I use he, him, and they, them pronouns, and it was amazing to get to be a part of the Edinburgh Ensemble this spring, to have this creative outlet that I got to engage with some of my closest peers on as we came to create something really meaningful during a time where we're all really looking for meaning. In the original production of Orlando that we were supposed to put on, I was slated to play the Queen, as well as various other characters, including Clorinda, a member of the ensemble, a spaniel, a boat. Really, I was gonna get the chance to dive into a lot of world building and character creation to help make the story of Orlando come to life, which I was so looking forward to. And so I got to really engage with the text as a whole rather than just one character's part, which I think was really helpful for while we were moving in to the virtual portion and engaging with the text in a different way.
Hi, I'm Olivia. I'm a junior in the College of Arts and Sciences, majoring in theater arts, and I was originally the stage manager for our production of Orlando. I'm from Colorado, but I'm currently sheltering in Philly with the service dog I'm training. This is Henry. Say hi, Henry.
Hi,
I'm Susett Tamayo, and I was going to perform the role of Orlando. I'm a theater arts major with an urban education minor, and I'm from Dallas, Texas, which is where I am now, with my mom, my dad, and my four sisters during this quarantine. Working on this new project during the pandemic has been such a rewarding experience. I've really gotten the chance to take it in and to really feel present in the moment and kind of make my experiences tangible and really let myself feel through it all. Each week I found myself thinking about time. Mostly in the beginning, it was memories and really thinking back on missing Penn, missing school, missing my friends. And quickly that turned into missing experiences that were interrupted, that didn't get to happen because of the quarantine. Revisiting the script at different points throughout this experience has really given me words to describe what I've been feeling and giving me a way to see Orlando's timeless story has really shown me that it is okay to not be at peace, and it's okay to find that peace throughout this process, and it's okay to reflect, it's okay to miss things, and it's okay to feel all of that at the same time.